All right, what's up, guys? Welcome back to the channel. And in today's video, I'm gonna be going over Gen Z. So it's already been a day. Well, not even a day. It hasn't even been 24 hours yet since the new patch has been live. But I'm already done with 1.1, so I figured why not just give you guys my Gen Z build. She has no dupes. She's pretty a free-to-play build, to be honest. It's pretty trash echo, so it's very, very relatable on what she can actually do. So if you are new here, leave a like on the video. Anyways. So Gen Z, she's strong. Is she worth it? Yes, she is worth it. Even if you don't have her weapon, she still does good damage. If you guys want to end up using Verdant Summit, still good damage at the end of the day. If you guys have Lustrous Razor, still gonna be good damage. You'll still hit over 100k crit even with Lustrous Razor. It's only when you get into the Battle Pass weapon, like Autumn Trace, is when damage is really not as good. But if you guys have the standard 5-star, it's totally fine. You don't have to pull Ages of Harvest. You know, it only really matters how much farther you want to get into tower. But going into Gen Z, basically stat lining here, stat lining kind of want at least 130 to 140 ER, because you know, her damage isn't centered around her ultimate skill, but her ultimate skill does do a lot of damage at the end of the day. When it comes to the attack, at this point in the game, if you're above being level 50, you kind of want to aim for around 2k attack. Actually, I cannot show it on anyone else. Oh, like Elshar almost has 2k, so about 1900 plus is what you're really looking for. 1800 if you have, like, you know, bad rolls. And then crit rate. Crit rate is always at least 60% is what you want. You try to have at least a 1-to-2 ratio. But crit damage, usually 230, 240 plus, is really, really good to have. Now, again, weapon, best weapon is Aegis of Harvest, no question. Basically, what her weapon does is that when she casts her intro skill, she gets a skill damage bonus of 12 seconds. And then when she casts her E, she gets an additional. So in total it will be 24. All right, so moving on, additional, so in total be 48% skill damage. I'm so sorry. All right, going into the echoes here, so her best set is going to be Celestial Light, and her best for a cost is going to be Jue. So if you guys were farming Mourning, is Mourning better? Absolutely not. Mourning is definitely not better. So the reason why Jue is better, not only is Jue a echo that you actually don't transform into, you actually summon Jue like this. And then at the end of Jue's animation, basically you'll get a skill damage bonus here. Now the skill damage bonus does last for 15 seconds, and Jue has a cooldown 20 seconds, I believe. So anytime that Jue is actually available, you always want to use Jue to get the skill damage bonus. So not only will, you know, your, was it the ordnance glow actually hit a lot harder. So it's just stacking more skill damage. Gen Z's whole gimmick is that all her damage comes from skill damage. So Jue is definitely the best echo on her. Now, when it comes to three costs, is attack percent better or spectral damage better? Spectral damage is better. It's already calculated. You guys can look anywhere else. Even if it's 1-to-1, it's about a 3% difference in the damage though. So if you guys do have trash spectral damage, three costs, you guys actually can run an attack percent on Celestial Light if you guys just did not get any of the good rolls here. So I have a couple here. Can't wait to roll these tonight. See if I actually get something good. That's way better than my spectral damage ones. And then one cost is obviously going to be your attack percent. Now, when it comes to the stats, what you're looking for is crit rate, crit damage, attack percent, skill damage, and then anything else after that. So after, you know, those, you know, crit rate, crit damage, attack percent is always the main three. But skill damage is very, very important. As you guys see, I have skill damage on everything, because skill damage is where her biggest damage output actually comes from. And then going into the Forte, now Forte priority is going to be her Forte circuit. That's where all her damage comes from. I know it's a very misconception where people like, oh, it's the skill that where all the damage comes from. No, it is not. Because that's only applies to Overflowing Radiant. Not when, which one is it? It does not apply to the Stellar Glamour damage. That's only Overflowing Radiant. Okay. And then after you level up a Forte circuit, the next one you'll level up is her Liberation skill, then her Resonance skill, Normal Attack, and then her Intro skill. Now, her Inherent skill here, you can level it up. The reason why I haven't done it yet is because I actually plan on leveling up her other skills first, because I don't really see her Intro skill being as important. And then when it comes to the dupes priority here, I do have S1. I just wanted to showcase her at S0, which I already did. If you guys haven't watched yet, I cleared Tower 3 star with Jinxi, Wanwu level 1, and Spectral MC S6. But best dupes to go for is S1, S4, and S6. Nothing in between. You don't want to stop in between. You get S1, S4, S6. There's the biggest damage outputs that you can possibly get. So that's basically going into the build of Jinxi. So we're going to talk about a little bit how she actually plays. It is very simple, even though she has the Great Wall of China text when it comes to, her trying to explain what she can do. So she has a basic 4 attack string like every single character in the game, obviously. You can do air attack, not something you're really going to do very often. You have your hold attack, which is basically your charge, or your heavy attack, something you're not going to do very often. Then you have the E skill, which is basically just you hitting through the enemy. I have your 4 basic attacks into the E. So this is the bread and butter agency. So you're always going to use 4 basic attacks into the E to transform into Incarnation. Now, after you use another 4 basic attacks into an E, you actually transform once again to the next transformation. So let me move this here. Okay, so I'm gonna jump in the air. Now we're still in Incarnation state. Then you can hold this as well. All right, so let's do 4 basic attacks into an E, and then we're now Incarnation, another 4 basic attacks into another E, and that's where Ordination Glow comes in, and that's where her big damage comes in. So very, very simple gameplay. Nothing really that difficult. I know it sounds difficult when you read a Great Wall of Text. It's very, very simple when it comes to the gameplay. Now, the cool thing about it is that when you use her Intro skill, she will automatically go into Incarnation state. So you don't need to do the 4 basic attacks at first. And when it comes to her best teammates for Jinxi. Now, Jinxi, again, I cleared this with 3 stars. I'm actually planning on trying to clear this with 3 stars. I actually have to level up Wanwu. But best team for Jinxi. So it really does depend on your account. For me personally, her best hybrid characters are either going to be Yenlin or it's going to be Mortify. Now, the reason why I'm not running them with her is because obviously I have Jian and Mortify and I have Calcharo and Yenlin. So it's not really ideal for me to actually run that. So I decided, hey, what can I figure out to run with her to help her get coordinated attacks? Oh, Wanwu. And he's level 1 because that's all he needs to be. And then another character where I thought of, oh, what's another character that I can actually run with Jinxi? It's actually Spectral MC. So the reason why I'm running Spectral MC with her is because you actually do get their S6. And basically, anytime that you use their E, it automatically lowers your spectral damage resistance by 10% on hit for 20 seconds. And yes, it does refresh, so you can constantly always have it on. This, honestly, if you compare it to Tao Qi's skill damage output on her outro, it's basically the same. You're not missing anything out because the resistance shred, honestly, helps clean up the mess at the end of the day. So, in my opinion, if you have a Jian team and you already have a Calcharo team, this is literally going to be the best team for her. I know a lot of people want to actually use Senua with her, obviously you can, but it's only really recommended if you do have S6, so that you at least will get a attack percent bonus on her, so you get some sort of value. If you actually do not have S6 Senua, then there really is no value at all, because even when Jin C is in her incarnation state, her attacks no longer count as basic attacks. Her regular attacks count as skill damage. So the main gimmick when it comes to Jin C is that what you want to do is not level up, but gain stacks on her Forte circuit. So the more stacks that she has on her Forte circuit at the bottom there, the more damage she'll output when using Ordnance Glow. Now, the way you build stacks is that Jin C builds stacks on her own per hit. If it is the same attribute as Jin C, which is another spectral character, it will be one stack per every 3 seconds. And then if you have a off element, so Electro, Spectro, but Electro, Fusion, you know, Yilin, Morphe, then you'll gain two stacks instead. So I'm going to show this a little bit off right now. I'm probably going to end up failing this. I'm really not going to try during this. I've already cleared this. But basically, the reason why I use Wanwu is because if you actually time it, and first of all, his E refreshes very fast. But if you can time it and actually line up the boss or whatever character you're fighting in the AoE, basically you can use Jin C's intro. And as you can already see, her stacks are already halfway. Now you're going to use Jue here to actually give you a skill damage bonus. And now we're going to use Ordnance Glow and 107,000 damage right there. And then you can use her ult after. Now, when you actually outro with Jin C, you want to actually switch to MC, because you don't want to switch to Wanwu, because you want MC to gain more Concerto energy so you can actually end up using Jin C again. And then as you guys see here, the damage, you know, as you guys can see, if you guys line up the coordinated attacks with Wanwu, she gets a plenty of stacks, like a lot. So you always want to try to keep the boss in the AoE. Now, it's not the easiest, you know, most of the time you'll get the boss in the AoE when the boss is maybe staggered or just like a slow phase. But if you are able to manage to keep the boss in the AoE for the most part, then you will get plenty of stacks, plenty of stacks. So I'm gonna ult here. I'm gonna end up using Jue because Jue is gonna give me a skill damage bonus increase. And as you guys can see here, the stacks are almost full. And even if the stacks aren't full all the way, it will still do great damage. Now again, we are getting buffed by the Abyss, so you know, normally your numbers won't be hitting that high, but you know, it still gets the job done at the end of the day. And you don't need a crazy broken team to actually clear this. I'm clearing this with S0 right now, as you guys already can tell, you know, from what I showed you guys. Now, I don't have to fake it. This is it's how it's being cleared. I'm actually not gonna 3-star this probably, because I need to actually min-max. So another thing you guys can actually do, if you're outro skill is not ready with MC, what you can do is that you can just switch to Jin C and use her normally with the 4 basic attacks to go into incarnation state instead of waiting for MC's outro. But yeah, that's basically, you know, her rotation, her gameplay. You know, if you want to min-max the gameplay to actually make sure you clear it on time, and even if you have better gear than I do, then you'll absolutely clear it. But yeah, overall, Jin C, amazing character. Pretty good stat scaling, honestly. I've seen plenty of people hit over 100k with her, have good damaging numbers with her, so that's great. You know, that's Jin C damage without even like Varina or Baji for the damage buff, so she has plenty of room for potential no matter on what account that you are on. Again, she's a main damage dealer, deals skill damage mostly, and overall she's just a really, really good investment. And I know a lot of people think that she's gonna get power crept like Gion. most likely not, because yeah, guys have to understand, It only gets better from here, because once she gets a dedicated buffer or a spectral damage buffer or a buffer that is way better than Tao Chi for skill damage, she's gonna hit even harder and a lot better. So thank you guys so much for watching this video. You know, if you guys are pulling for Gen C, I wish you guys good luck on your pulls. I hope, you know, you guys get her and yeah, you do crazy damage with her. All right, if you guys are going for dupes as well, then hey, good luck on your 50-50s. But I do stream this game every single day. You guys can always stop by, ask questions, things like that. Leave a like if you guys haven't yet, subscribe. And I'll see you all in the next one. Peace.